Okay. Move out. June 6, 1944, a date that would be remembered as D-Day. A day of rough weather and murderous enemy fire that would make this landing in France a nightmare. But it would mark another proud chapter in the history of the fighting outfit known as the Big Red One. For the 1st Division held Omaha Beach and drove inland. The invasion of Europe was on. Mm-hmm. 21 years later, July 1965. This was a relaxed, quiet operation compared to that historic landing of World War II. There were officers and men here who had taken part in the D-Day landing in Europe. For the most part, these were young men, trainees new to combat. Trainees and hardened veterans alike were here to help stop a fanatical communist aggressor from swallowing up another corner of Asia. And in so doing, they would add still another heroic chapter to the story of the 1st Division. The outfit that had been a spearhead division in two world wars. The Big Red One was in Vietnam.
Although combat was new to us, I think we all knew what it meant to wear that patch. You just don't train with the 1st Infantry Division and remain an ordinary soldier. There's too much history and tradition. Too many battles and victories. It was organized in World War I, when it was the first American division to see combat. But some of its units have battle streamers that go back to the Civil War. Battery D of the 5th Field Artillery, commanded by Alexander Hamilton, fought in the Revolutionary War. It has the longest record of continuous service of any unit in the Army. To all of us in the 1st Infantry Division, its long, proud record was not just a footnote in a history book. It was a living tradition. We knew that we were not only with the first, but with the best. Every soldier on that beach was ready to prove it, and we'd soon have plenty of chances to do just that. More men of the 1st were coming ashore at Camran Bay and Vung Tau. So by October, there were 10,000 of us. The 1st, 2nd, and 3rd Brigades, plus artillery, armored cavalry, service and support elements. We set up base camps in the Saigon area and went to work, digging. We dug trenches, foxholes, and sites for gun emplacements. For automatic weapons, mortars, and artillery. We nailed down tarpaulins, put sandbags around mortar sites, cleared away the grass for fields of fire. Zeroed in the mortars and emplaced our 105. A big part of our job was plain hard shovel and spade work. When we got through housekeeping and setting up perimeter security, we would write a quick note home about the hot, humid weather and the strange country. We didn't realize how strange it was until we went out on our first patrols near Benoit. In all the varied combat history of the 1st Division, we never fought on terrain like this. Tall grass and jungle, in a steaming climate, soggy with humidity. It was only the first of many such patrols. Miserable, exhausting, dull. But they hardened us to the climate and the terrain, and gave us knowledge of an evasive enemy. We came to know that anything went with the Viet Cong, and we learned to trust no one. This 16-year-old boy might have had a grenade in his basket instead of a dead pet. We found incredible underground fortifications the VC had built and which we destroyed. The patrols got longer as we swept larger and larger areas, so they had to send in choppers to resupply us. These birds were to come in many times to help us, and we got to love the guys who manned them. They had an infantryman's gut. There was still no real contact with the enemy, but we knew that sooner or later we'd tangle with them. The VC knew our battle reputation, and we figured they wanted to test us almost as much as we wanted to test them. The first big action came near a place called, would you believe it, Bao Bang. A hardcore VC reinforced regiment tried to jump us. We didn't sit still and take it. We carried the fight to them. We called in artillery and air support. They clobbered the VC escape route. Some of us got hurt, but the VC left almost 200 dead. We were bushed, too tired to show we were happy, but we were. We had proven Charlie wasn't 10 feet tall. He was tough, but not as tough as the men of the 1st Division. We thought things would stay lively after Bao Bang, but they didn't. Soldiering was mostly footwork. They called these patrols search and clear operations, and that's what we did. We hunted the enemy across fields, down roads, jungle trails, and rice paddies. We kept our feet dry when we could, which wasn't often. It was dirty, sweaty work. We'd take a break, but we couldn't really relax. We felt the VC were always close, hidden by the jungle, waiting for a chance to jump us. So we had to be on guard all the time. At night, we set up strong defensive positions and stayed alert. Sometimes even alertness wasn't enough against a sniper, a punji stick, or a booby trap. But medevac was always there to get out the wounded in a hurry. The rest of us kept on searching. Sometimes the hamlets were abandoned, but often we had to evacuate the villagers. It was a rough deal for some of them, but we could never be sure which ones were VC sympathizers. The grim fact was that those who looked like they most deserved sympathy were often the ones who shielded the Viet Cong or hid their weapons. Still, we couldn't help feeling sorry for these people. As soon as we were organized, we sent out civic action teams, like these medics, to see what we could do for them. While the medics held sick call inside the building, the kids were kept busy learning how to count in English. These cute little Vietnamese youngsters could steal your heart away. Meanwhile, back in the boondocks, the search and clear routine went on and on. There were a lot of French rubber plantations in this area. We knew the VC exacted tribute from their owners, but there was no sign of Charlie. So we searched some more. We splashed through so many rice paddies, they should have called this an amphibious operation. Where the ground was hard enough, we were joined by tanks and armored personnel carriers. These were the boys from the 1st Division's mechanized cavalry, and we were glad to have them. We were glad, too, for the choppers that buzzed overhead, trying to spot the VC for us from the air. Our contact with the enemy was mainly from what he left behind. If it wasn't a hut, it was a hole, often leading to an amazing underground nest of factories, dormitories, and hospitals. We'd clear them and keep searching. That was the way it was most of the time, pushing our way through the jungle and heavy brush. Taking a break, then going on. Vietnam looks pretty small on the map, but it's plenty big when you move around in it on foot. Gradually, systematically, we cleared the area around division headquarters at Xi'an, pushing out to places like Benoit, Bear Cat, Phu Loi, and Ben Cat. They gave these search and clear missions some pretty wild titles. Bushwhacker, Viper, Bloodhound, Smash, Roadrunner, Hopscotch. But most of the time, only the names were exciting. Now and then there was contact with the enemy, usually unseen, but who often left his mark. War is always a bloody business. It's hard to tell you what it means to the guy with the rifle to know that if he's hit, he'll be on his way to a field hospital in a matter of minutes. Now and then we got a diversion, the fun kind. Bob Hope and his troop presented a Christmas show. Like all of the entertainers who come over here, they were really appreciated. These people have heart and courage, and all of their shows and visits are memorable times for everybody in the division. When 1966 rolled around, we knew things would start heating up, and they did. We had a new base camp at Lai K, north of Saigon. So we moved out to police the area of Viet Cong, not cigarette butts. We got armor on this push. The tank boys must have enjoyed it. It wasn't often they got good open terrain like this. There were APCs too. We were all throwing a lot of lead, but there was lots more ammo where this came from. When we gave the signal, the choppers would come in with more. January was a busy month. We struck the VC outside our third base camp at Phuc Vinh. That was Operation Quick Kick, followed by Crimp, Mallet, and Buckskin. A lot of it was by chopper, hoping to catch the enemy by surprise. Meanwhile, the Air Force was pounding away. So was the artillery, with fantastic accuracy, seeking to destroy the Viet Cong or pin him down. We came in immediately after by Huey, or Chinook. Then we moved out on the trail of the VC, which, as often as not, was underwater. There were plenty of underground bunkers to search. We were polite. We always knocked first, with a grenade. We didn't usually catch any of the little men inside, but we often found some interesting papers, documents, and diaries. Seems that a lot of VC didn't like being away from home. Well, we sympathize with that. Surprise, a red flag. Sometimes going through captured materiel was like sorting out an international junk pile. The weapons were Chinese, Russian, German, Czech, sometimes American. The cameras were French. The telephone, Czech. The typewriter, I don't know, it could have come from anywhere. I've got to say a word for the guys who went into these tunnels to look for VC. We call them tunnel rats, But never was a nickname meant as a greater compliment. It took raw guts to go down into those dark holes. They were all volunteers. Once in a while, we were lucky. We took Charlie by surprise. Quite a few of our prisoners were ready to talk. They seemed glad to be out of the war. But for all who gave up, there were lots more in the bush. So we kept on searching. We must have been doing something right. They passed out a lot of medals for the Big Red One. Vice President Humphrey himself made some of the presentations. A lot of the medals were silver stars and bronze stars with V for Valor. Fighting Men's Awards. It was about that time that we got our first Medal of Honor for Vietnam, awarded posthumously to Lieutenant Robert Hibbs. His 15-man ambush patrol chopped up two Viet Cong companies. Then Lieutenant Hibbs went back for a wounded man. Already wounded himself, he charged VC machine guns to cover the man's evacuation. Then they cut him down. After the awards, it was back to the boondocks. One operation after another. Salem, Wheaton, Lexington, Monroe, you name it. We'd fly through the air with the greatest of ease. Then hit the ground, where the going was slow and rough. And hot. Hot? It was hotter than Philadelphia in August, and digging in didn't help to cool off. For some soldiers, the heat was just too much. Then a chopper would come in to take out the man for a short rest. But most of us just took it and kept going. And if you wanted to smile about it, well, that got you at least 5 brownie points. I used to envy the guys who rode tanks, but once I got into the jungle, I changed my mind. In this kind of climate where temperature and humidity are sky high, walking is better than riding in those hot boxes. Faster, too. They trucked us whenever they could, but then we had to eat dust like this. As I said, walking was better than riding. But even the routine of this hot, sweaty war had a nice surprise now and then. This wasn't a cruise boat, but riding across water made it feel a little cooler. It was a nice illusion while it lasted, which wasn't for long. No matter how often we went into the jungle, it was always a little frightening at first. It wasn't just the unseen enemy. It was the feeling of isolation, the limited mobility, the difficulty of movement that wore at the nerves as much as the muscles. Yet even at the worst, we never felt completely shut off or out of touch. There was always radio on the ground, and either choppers or jets overhead looking out for our interests. Then there were the chaplains. I can't tell you how much we admired these men, regardless of which religion they stood for. They thought enough of us and the message they brought to come right into the hot spots in VC country where we were. Some of them didn't make it back. We could feel the war expanding. Operation Abilene, our next mission, was a division-sized sweep. Its purpose was to sanitize a big chunk of Phuc Thuy province southeast of Saigon. It was a well-planned operation. There was plenty of armor and support. Artillery around the clock. And jets. We'd make a sweep. If there was no contact, we'd let headquarters know. They'd send in the choppers and off we'd go to search another area. We cleaned out hundreds of VC fortifications this way. And got us quite a bag of prisoners. We had our reward, too. A pass to Saigon. The sergeant major briefed us on civilian booby traps in town. It was a strange feeling to dress up neat and clean in civvies, and believe me, we made the most of it. All too soon, we were back in the jungle again, on our next mission. They were coming thick and fast and big, like Operations Birmingham and El Paso. There was a whole series of actions all summer long to clean up Ambush Alley, Highway 13. Our mechanized cavalry played a leading role. We lured the Viet Cong into attacking us and then struck back. It was a long, hot summer, all right, but it was the enemy who sweated the most. We completely disrupted his plans for a monsoon offensive. There was also plenty of action away from the many battlefields on which the first was fighting. We were feeding a lot of villagers and their kids, plus building schools and hospitals for them. We wanted to build up their morale to resist the VC and to have confidence in us as their friends. Besides, we were just suckers for the kids. It was surprising the different kinds of talent there were in the division. Well, maybe the soldier clown couldn't make it at Barnum and Bailey, but the youngsters sure loved him. It was the medical care that most impressed the adults. It really got to them when we rid them of ailments they'd accepted all their lives as natural afflictions. They were hardly less impressed when our veterinary teams treated their animals. Maybe it seems odd to reach the minds and hearts of the Vietnamese through their pigs and cows, but it worked. Our pride in the division got another boost when its Sergeant Major, Bill Wooldridge, was picked to become the first Sergeant Major of the Army. It seemed only natural to us that the job should go to a man from the 1st Division. In the fall, we jumped off on the biggest sweep of the war up to that time. It was Operation Attleboro, and it marked the second year of combat in Vietnam for the 1st Infantry Division. We moved back into Tay Ninh province for this one, determined to show the VC that we would strike them again and again in the same area. They tried to jump some of us, but we fought back with small arms till support came up. More men came streaming up on foot and on APCs. Fighter planes were busy. Artillery was flown in. The enemy was pounded around the clock. We took some losses, but medevac was there, Johnny on the spot, to take out our wounded. We took a sizable bag of prisoners, besides killing more than 800 of the VC. Around Christmas time, combat operations slowed down. Christmas in Vietnam. It was a little unreal in 100-degree heat, 10,000 miles from home. But one thing was genuine, the joy the kids had in Santa Claus, even if they weren't sure just who he was. We laid it on with a band. All the ice cream the kids could eat. They had a great time, and so did we. ...1967 opened up with the biggest campaign of the war, Operation Cedar Falls in the Iron Triangle. This was a vast communist stronghold just 20 miles northwest of Saigon. The VC in the Triangle had always been a threat to Saigon. Now we were going to crush that threat. Cedar Falls was a multi-division affair with 28 battalions committed. The entire triangle was surrounded to cut off escaping VC. Simultaneously, the main attack force struck deep inside the enemy stronghold. Much of the area is hostile jungle, so thick in places that the choppers couldn't land, and the men had to descend by trooper ladders. We pushed off into the jungle and found ourselves on some of the roughest terrain we'd ever come across. Thickets, vines, tall grass, water. Sometimes it was only wading deep, but many times we had to use a rope to get across. And there was mud, lots of it. Nonetheless, we kept moving and searching, sometimes without incident, and sometimes meeting resistance that brought on several firefights. To destroy the triangle as a Viet Cong sanctuary, we bulldozed broad stretches of jungle. Villagers were evacuated en masse. It would be a long time before the Viet Cong would find the Iron Triangle hospitable again. Big as Cedar Falls was, Operation Junction City was even bigger. Preparations were thorough and painstaking. We were going into an area called War Zone C to hunt for the main headquarters of the Viet Cong. A huge fort was deployed in the form of a giant horseshoe, enclosing 250 square miles. 30,000 men were used to close the trap. At the beginning of Junction City, contact with the enemy was light. But then the tactic of deep patrolling paid off. The VC were lured repeatedly into attacking our advanced units with mortar and machine gun fire. Many small patrols held out against tremendous odds while the enemy was pulverized by artillery. And repeated airstrikes. Many units and individuals distinguished themselves by their coolness and professional behavior under attack. Yet most of these soldiers had never been in battle before. Operation Junction City was a huge success for the 1st Infantry Division. In four major battle actions, the men of the Big Red One accounted for 1,100 of the 2,600 Viet Cong killed in this campaign.
The grind of war in Vietnam goes on for the 1st Division. Most of the men in this story have gone home, rotated out of combat. Those who have replaced them carry on with the same will to win, the same calm certainty of victory that marks every soldier of the 1st Infantry Division. Proud of an incomparable battle history, never shadowed by defeat, the man who wears the Big Red One knows he will live up to the division motto. No mission too difficult, no sacrifice too great. Duty first.